Okay, thank you, Mas, for the kind introduction. We will talk for the next coming 3/4 of an hour to 1 hour about the earthquakes and how to deal with it in the Netherlands, and especially how to use DIANA in that analysis. First, something about the new service we have introduced within Tino DIANA. It's the engineering service. It's a special service to help people who are already using DIANA in their projects. Whenever there is shortage of time, where projects have demands to deliver reports and there is no people who can do the projects, then we can help. Lend a helping hand to overcome the schedules, or maybe some users do not have a good know-how about a certain workflow in a new topic and want to have an example within that project, then we can most probably can help you with setting up how the project can be analyzed in DIANA. Up to making a report, and which you can supply to your clients. So in this setting, there are several topics we can assist you with. One is setting up models, the second one is carrying out analysis, and the third is reporting. Whatever you want and how we can help you, just drop an email at engineering@tno.com for any further assistance or information. So it's just to make life easier for all the DIANA users all over the world. Then I come to the main topic of this afternoon, that's the earthquake in the Netherlands. It's recently been discovered. I will explain that later on, and I have some sample demonstration cases to go through. Further in this session, I will demonstrate apartment, new building, an apartment tower, some monumental building, a church in the village of Winsum, and I will start with some masonry housing, which is built a lot in the northern part, or all over Holland in fact, but also in the northern part of Holland where we have the earthquake at the moment. Some typical topics that are important and basic principles about these housings is that their design is efficient. That means there is capacity to bear the loads from the dead weight, some user loads, wind load, and that's it. In a lot of cases, the wind load is even not met with the building that is built for almost 50, 60 years ago. Also, there are settlements of the soil in the northern part of Holland, which can cause already before the earthquake signals some serious damage in the, with respect to cracking and degradation of the building. Well, a typical construction of the building, you can see on this photo, there is a lot of windows in front and the back of the building to let the sun through, to have some light in the house. And between the several apartments, there are cavity walls. So those walls are reasonably stiff, and that means that the ground, the resistance of the building from the front to the back facade is reasonable good. But in the other direction, that's the direction along the row of the buildings, we have not so much capacity. It's a weak construction because of all those windows and doors that weaken the facade. Most of the times it's a cavity wall, so an inner wall bearing the slabs, the floors on levels, and an outer panel that is not bearing the structure. And during earthquake, we must take into account that the outer panel could fall against the inner panel as a horizontal load. So furthermore, these kind of buildings are dry stapled, so not good connections between the walls and the floors and the slabs on the levels. Most of the time they're just placed on top of each other. Sometimes there are wooden floors with beams, other times there is a hollow core slab. All kind of topologies are there. What they all have in common is that the ductility is not so high. So how to deal with a big amount of houses with a low ductility from the past? That's what we want to show in this webinar. Therefore, we have taken an example case which is described in the new Dutch guideline for earthquakes. You have to know that the Eurocode 8 is accepted, of course, also in Holland, but we didn't write an annex, national annex for the Eurocode 8 up to now. So as a country, we are now very much busy with making guidelines, and the next step will be a national application document. How can the signal be schematized in the Groningen situation? We looked at the Eurocode, and in the new guideline is written here as MPR 9998 in Groningen, the green line. That is the signal, the response spectrum diagram that we have to take into account. And that more or less is the same as the Eurocode 8 type 1, 2 and salt type C. Why do we have a problem in Holland? At this slide you see the hazard map of Europe. Of course, as everybody knows, Turkey has a big earthquake history, also in Greece and Italy, but in Holland the earthquakes up to a couple of years ago just were known only in the southern part, and that are relatively mild earthquakes on a deeper depth because they are the tectonic earthquakes. But since some 50 years we are taking out gas in this area of north of Holland, also in some other areas. It's good to know, but the earthquake are arising now for a decade or so in Groningen, and only recently, a few years ago, they grew in amounts of earthquakes during the season and during the years, but also in strength, and especially the last one is important because it is prognosed that the strength of the earthquake will even become higher for the coming years. The reason of having this earthquake nowadays in Groningen is because we are extracting gas from the soil on a depth of 2 to 3 kilometers, and the lowering of the pressure in the soil layers gives more compacting of the soil, and of course that goes with shocks, and therefore the earthquakes arise. Because it's not so deep, only 2-3 kilometers, the signal can go very good up to the soil level, and we have a high peak ground acceleration, much higher than tectonic earthquake compared to a tectonic earthquake. You can also see that on the next slide, where we have in the south of Holland, in around Limburg, Roermond, that is called. We have had some earthquakes on the magnitude of the scale of Richter, the magnitude 5 to 6. But at a depth, the epicenter at a depth of 10 to 30 kilometers. Well, recently in the northern part of Holland at Groningen, we have the induced earthquakes at a depth of 2 to 3 kilometers. And there was a big or a reasonable earthquake 2012 in Huizingen that came to 3.6 on the scale of Richter. Well, for all over the world, people are saying that's not so high, that's true, but if you know that the expected peak ground accelerations in the future will be up to 0.42, then you understand that for the future, for these kind of housings, we have a serious problem. The peak ground acceleration that is measured from the earthquake in 2012 is 0.086. So that's not so high yet, but we have to take into account the more severe signals for the future. In Holland, we have made a map for the guideline giving the signal to take into account in the province of Groningen. With a, you could say, an epicenter of the hazard map in around Loppersum, where we have to take into account a peak ground acceleration of 0.42. There are some important places in this province. At first we have the big city of Groningen, where we have to take the signals up to 0.2 or 0.25 G as acceleration. And we have some chemical plant sites in the northern eastern part where we can have where we have prognosed accelerations raising up to 0.25 to 0.35 G, where all kind of chemical conducts and plants with connections have to be taken care of. In between, we have a lot of villages, a lot of farming, a lot of houses with a lot of monuments as well, old houses that we want to keep in a good state. But at this moment, for the coming years, the main interest is preventing casualties. And that means that we are mostly looking at a near collapse state and not at a damage limitation state too much. Also, the guideline is set up for the code checking for the Dutch situation for a near collapse. Having explained a little bit about the situation in Groningen, I want to go to the program Diana and show you the different methods that are available for checking and doing the analysis. Well, the first one which can be used is the RSA, a response spectrum analysis. That means that you are doing a linear analysis with different eigenmodes that are taken into account in one calculation. The advantage that is mentioned more often is that it is faster. This is of course because it's a linear calculation and you have no convergence problems, so you could say it is a fast calculation. But if you have a big apartment building, which we show later on, for instance, or another structure that is very big with a lot of small eigenmodes, local eigenmodes of slabs, of walls, then the total mass that is excitated can be very small for each eigenmode. So you have to take a lot of eigenmodes into account to come to the code checking of around 70-90% of the total mass of the building. And sometimes you do not come even there. Taking all these Eiker modes into account will lead up to a very big matrices that takes a lot of time during the calculation. So faster, yes, but not always. The big advantage is that you can take more Eiker modes into the one calculation, of course. But there are also some disadvantages. These can be found, at first, of course, because it's a linear calculation, you will not see any failure mechanism. You will only see some stresses that arise and stresses that will be situated at some points, but it doesn't mean that the construction is collapsing there or there is failure, because maybe if you do a non-linear calculation you can have some redistribution of the stresses. So you can only say at that point the stress is higher than my linear stress, and it could be wrong, but you have to interpret the data yourself. The program is not doing that for you. Another disadvantage is how to add the different stresses for the different mode shapes. It's the second one. There are available in YANA three kinds of adding methods. You can just for each shape calculate the stresses and add them absolute. You can also take the square root of squares, or you can look, and that's the last method, or the in-between method you could say, where you look at how far the different Eiker modes are apart from each other for the natural period or the frequency, and if they are close together you add them more, and if they're far apart you don't add the stresses for that part of the structure. So that's the most reliable, you could say, and the most used for us as well, is the CQC method. You can find it also on the manual on the website. It's CQC. The next disadvantage is that you cannot bring much detail in your construction. You cannot implement cracking since it's a linear calculation, and therefore also interfaces can only be applied with a constant spring stiffness in tension as well in compression. And most of the times with these kinds of masonry houses which we have in Holland and those structures, we have no tension capacity of the masonry connections with the slabs, for instance. So there we would like to have a nonlinear interface, and it's not possible with your RSA analysis. Anyway, we will show in this webinar the outcome of the RSA, and it's good to do it for a structure to get familiar with the structure. But as you can see later on, you cannot draw any conclusions from it, or not too much. Then the second method is the pushover analysis. Sorry for sometimes the misspelling in English. It's a converted, translated PowerPoint from Dutch. Sorry about that. It's a nonlinear calculation for just one Eiker mode. So for each mode shape, each Eiker mode, you have to do another pushover analysis, and in fact you have to do it twice if you want to do it good, because it can sway one way or 180 degrees the other way. Sometimes it doesn't matter for the building when it's symmetric, but sometimes with non-symmetry it could matter. And another topic for the pushover analysis that you can take into account, both the geometrical, so the second order aspects, and also the nonlinear behavior of the material physical. And that helps a lot when looking at earthquakes. So this is a big step forward with respect to the RSA calculation, the first linear one. Because the advantage of the pushover is that cracking is shown during the loading procedure, and therefore a possible failure when you come at the end of the pushover curve is shown for each mode. You know what are the weakest spots of your structure, and you can search those spots to strengthen them or to do some cross-sectional design for those. Another advantage is that you can take into account the local behavior. So if you have already pre-cracked zones, like in the masonry buildings because of the settlements, you can implement those cracks, or you can give weaker material to those spots. And as well, you can implement interfaces, for example, for the connections of the beams for the slabs to the wall, or the walls to the slabs, as well as for the substructure, the soil interaction. And that's very useful. And a lot of more simplified calculation methods, where they say they do a pushover calculation. For instance, the beams to the walls are fixed. And sometimes you can see that there is a lot of internal force in those beams, which is not which cannot happen in reality, because the connection of the beams bearing the slabs on the first level and second level of a housing are placed with no connection in the inner panel of the masonry structure. So it has a little bit of friction because of the weight of the floor slabs and the load on top of it, but not too much more than that. And if you build in an interface between the connection of the beam and the masonry wall, then you can much more precise say what the exact advantage of the beam is, or when it will slide in your calculation. When it will slide, it has no capacity anymore. Now, of course, this method also has a disadvantage, and the main one is that you have to do the pushover analysis for each mode shape, and you have to look yourself which mode shapes are dominant and the most important. We can guide you through that process if necessary. Then the last one, the most sophisticated, you could say, the most compared close to the reality, is the non-linear time history analysis. Here we give a true time acceleration signal, either to the bedrock, to the bottom of the bottom of the model, so you can say underneath the soil, or you can place it on the bottom of the foundation of the structure. It depends on what you want to look at. Again, like with the pushover, you can make your material physical nonlinear, or you can add also geometrical nonlinearity in your model. Well, it's obvious that the advantages are the same as for the pushover. The cracking is shown. You see possible failures for each signal. And an advantage with respect to the pushover is that you now will take all the modes within one calculation, because you put the real signal on your model. And depending on your natural periods, your eigenfrequencies, the modes will be excitated or not. And there you see at the same time the disadvantage. You need some signals. The code prescribes how much signals you need, at least some 7 to 10 signals, depending on some parameters of your structure. And that will take time. So calculating those signals for one structure will take more time than your RSA, and either as much time as your pushover or a little bit more. And of course, you have to have knowledge about the signal. The signal should be available. And when you have earthquakes only recently, like our case in Groningen, for some 5 years, there are not much signals available. And therefore, we are making them artificial, following the spectral responses diagram, and we're trying to make more signals that can also be used for the bigger earthquake events which we have prognosed in Holland up to the 0.42 g of acceleration. And that's ongoing work. Well, to have some more description about the housing case, it's a precast beams foundation normally. So underneath is precast, of, or the older ones are a masonry on grade. And sometimes it's a precast beam with pals or on grade. The bearing walls are cavity walls, so it's 120 millimeter of limestone on the inner side, then a cavity of 60 millimeter, and an other wall of 120 millimeter bearing the slabs on level. In this case, the slabs are hollow core slabs, concrete slabs that can be calculated in this case as linear. They are in reality pre-stressed and very stiff and strong with respect to the masonry. And they have enough ductility in them being not normative for the calculations. The roof tells, and the roof is only taken into account as a mass, because in this example, it is said that the roof is supported enough by the roof beams. Also, a middle house in a row is analyzed. As you can see here, it has a width of about 5 meters, 5.4 between the housings, and a depth of the house from the front facade to the back facade is around 8.5 meters. These housing fall in the Eurocode class CC1B, and we have to take into account an importance factor, partial factor of 1.2 according to the Dutch guidelines. Well, if we set up the model, you remember from the first picture that there was a window here and some other masonry and a door. We all stripped that. This is basically the stripped building where we have in Dutch the so-called pennants that are the bearing walls, orthogonal to the walls that shed the different apartments or housings. So in this direction there's a lot of strength. There's the 120 millimeter limestone, and in the front, in the this direction, it's a lot weaker. We only have 0.5 meter of this bearing walls. And we have an active wall. If we assume that the building is pushed over to one side, the right positive X side in this case, then this is an active wall, and a not active wall. That is because of the wall being loose from the slabs, and it's modeled Indiana with an interface that can have no tension. The bottom you can see as follows: the cross wall, the bearing wall in front, the slab, the hollow core slab, and then we have the connection. It's an interface connection between the masonry wall and the hollow core slab, having compression and no stiffness in tension, and a connection to a foundation beam which is supported either on pals or on grade. Also, the foundation beams is taking linear. Then for the materials, we have made two calculations. One calculation with design values for the compression and one calculation with more mean values for compression. For the masonry, limestone, the maximum compression strength is around 10 MPa, and for design values more closely to 4 MPa. The code or the guideline prescribes material behavior stress strain relationship up to 3.5 promille, and then it should fall down to zero stress. For convergence sake in the calculations, we most always like to have a full parabolic shape up to a higher strain. As long as the amount of energy is not growing bigger, it should cause no problem, but it's not written in the guideline, the Dutch guideline yet. On the tensile side, we have tensile strength of around 0.2 being as a design value for the limestone and a linear softening diagram. Then some basic outcome of the guideline calculations that was not done with Deanna. The force, base shear force that can get taken up by one housing is around 28 kilonewtons with a ductility behavior a little bit. If you make the bilinear diagram, you come to 16 millimeter and around 36, 37 millimeter. The lowest frequency is around 1.38 hertz and 0.8 is a natural period. With those figures and the response spectrum diagram, you have to take into account this response spectrum load, and the ductility can be expressed via the bilinear diagram as a factor of the maximum displacement and the end of the linear elastic displacement quotation. It's 1.65, and the Q factor, the shape factor or ductility factor, can be calculated from that as 1.5. When we calculate it in Deanna, we see the first dominant shape. It's a global shape with compression on the cross walls here and tension of course on this side, and then you come to eigenfrequency of around 1.4 and natural period the same. So that looks okay to the simplified calculation because it's a very simplified building. You also have some higher eigenmode shapes. The second shape, the rotation shape, rotational shape, and local shapes where the walls are in high order modes. You have to take that into account as well, since the masonry cannot have too much tension and there is not a lot of vertical load. These can be normative, but for this webinar we only look at the first eigenmode shape, this global shape. If you do a response spectrum analysis, then you will find that the stresses can be tension or compression because it's symmetrical always, the RSA, the linear calculation. So you have here around 10 MPa compression and tension. It's good to evaluate, as I told you, where are some stresses, but you cannot say this is too high or too low because having here a tension of 10 is not real, and if you lack that tension, then it could give much more compression on this side, for instance. So that's why we go over to the pushover analysis on the shape, on the same first eigenmode shape, and in that push over, you can also take into account some viscous damping. And if you want some hysteresis damping, we introduce this formula taken from the bilinear diagram. So it's an you have to make a first pushover analysis to actually calculate this value, and do a second one including the hysteresis. But it can help you significantly with masonry buildings, as the damping coefficient can be doubled depending on the ductility. If you do the pushover diagram for the mean value, that's the higher red curve, or the design value, that's the lower blue curve, then we see that the simplified calculation method is in between. So all is as expected, you could say, for the simple housing. And with this pushover curve, you can code check to the Eurocode whether it's good or not. Looking more closely to the cross walls, being this the active pennant in compression, during the pushover load, the tension compression will be will increase here, and reaching a maximum compression strain. And after that, later on in the pushover curve, that gives a fall, a drop of your compression stresses as expected. There you can see the nonlinear behavior of the pushover and the nonlinear behavior of the materials and the capacity. We can show that in a movie. What is happening when you push over the building? On the right side, you see the behavior of the building with the mean compression strength, and on the left side, you see the behavior of the materials with the design value. The two top pictures give the final crack state, and you see that the pattern is completely different, or completely, it is different. For design value, the passive cross wall will crack, and for the mean values, the other walls will crack. And this is more the expected cracking, which typically is for masonry out of plane. Well, as I told you from the pushover diagram in the Dutch guideline, a bilinear diagram is calculated, is drawn, and a Q factor is calculated from that. And in sequence, the response spectrum diagram is decreased with the Q factor, and a second pushover with design materials is made, and it is expected that you should be able to raise the pushover load up to this value for the design values of the materials. Now, that's described in the Dutch annex. We would like to present another checking method. It's more based on the Annex B of the Eurocode 8.1, also called as the N2 method. To be able to check it according to the Annex B, we have to rewrite the response spectrum diagram, and we do that by rewriting it to a force displacement diagram for the single DOF system. How are we going to do that? We take the spectra response and we multiply that by the M star, and we get this signal DOF force. On the horizontal axis, the displacement we would like, we take the spectrum and we divide it by the circular frequency in square, the squared circular frequency. Doing that, we end up with the demand spectrum. We call it the force displacement response spectrum. You can write plot your pushover diagram. These are the different possibilities for different calculations in the same graph. That means that you take your pushover diagram of your multi-DOF system divided by your transformation factor, and you end up with your single DOF system, your single DOF force and your single DOF displacement. Either you can get above your demand, that's okay of course, or you can stay below and you can add a bilinear diagram, and if you say the first branch of the bilinear diagram is your circular frequency, you can extend that branch up to your demand graph, and from there you find your demand displacement. And of course your pushover should be increased up to the demand displacement or more far. You can bilinear diagram extended can be in between the natural frequency B or C. Either it can be between C and D, or it can be higher more than TD. And these are the different kinds of situations to check. Well, our building has an M-star of around 50 tons, and the transformation factor is calculated in Diana automatically in development. It will be available in one of the next versions, so you don't have to calculate that yourself. Diana is doing that for you. And with the M-star and the transformation factor, you can scale your pushover diagram and check whether your demand is lower than the end of the pushover diagram. To look a little bit more at this diagram, I go to the next slide where I zoomed in on the y-axis. And as you can see, the bilinear diagram is extended to the demand. From the demand, we have around 22 millimeter to take into account. And our pushover diagram goes more far. So we can take up 0.17 g, we say, because we made this demand spectrum on a value of 0.17 g. For Diana, we say it's good to have some extra ductility after your demand, and we multiplied the first demand with 150% up to around 33 millimeter. It is arbitrary whether you should do that, whether you want to have some extra capacity or not. As you can see from the pushover diagram and from the frequencies that you find with the pushover diagram, the single DOF system has a lower frequency than the linear multi-DOF system of the first mode shape. That was 1.4, and now we end up with 0.92. And the one most important effect which causing this drop in stiffness is the interface, for example. In the pushover diagram and the single DOF system, we don't have tension in our interfaces. The next step you could take is putting a time signal on the case. We did it in three directions. It's the real signal of the 2012 earthquake in Groningen, only it's extended for a higher amplitude, a bigger amplitude. We have put the signal in X, Y, and Z direction, and then you end up with something like this, where the movements of the building are plotted on the right during time steps, and on the left time, left hand, you will see the crack propagation for this signal. And of course you should put some more signals on the structure to get all the eigenmodes excitated. But in this simple case you see that the first eigenmode is definitely there. You see as well the cracking from the mean material strength, as well the cracking which we saw for the design compression strength, sorry. So it's very good that we see and follow the pushover diagrams. That gives confidence about the way of checking. Since 0.17 is lower than the acceleration we have to take into account for 0.42g, we want to strengthen it. And we are part of a technical committee with a lot of parties, a lot of companies, and some companies have made up some strengthening measures. Royal Haskoning designs frame in front and back of the housings, so a column, steel column at each cross wall, and ABT Wassenaar did make a portal or a frame, it's more a frame, for only just one cross wall, and the other buildings, houses, are coupled through their slabs and through a steel joints or steel girder in front and back of the housing. Well, both are possible, and we calculated them. You see some details about the other framework which has to come for each housing. And if you look at the pushover diagrams, we first had around 28 as a base shear force, and now we end up with about 400 kilonewtons. So that helps a lot. But this was a simple case, and if the complexity of the masonry building grows, then it's more likely to use some high order calculations. So I quickly go to the next housing, which is also consists of masonry, only there are a lot of inner walls in all kind of directions, and we can assume that it is hard to manually see how the forces during earthquake follows. Here you see the deflection of the normal dead weight. The first slab on the first level is a concrete slab. It's again a cavity wall. We only modeled for the stiffness the inner wall, and the outer wall is taking as a mass horizontally to the inner walls. We added the roof elements just for stiffness sake to connect the beams in the roof. The roof is not connected to the masonry structure since there is no tension capacity there. The sole is taking into account the interaction with the sole through interfaces. And if we look at the eigenmodes, we see first in the global X direction, global mode. The second one is in the Y direction, and the third one is a rotational mode. And you can see it's already local a little bit, and that's something we're facing with more difficult geometries. The first mode is a global mode, and you can check it again through the Annex B method, whether it applies to the code or not. But the second mode, if you do a pushover, the chimney falls off. The third mode, if you do the pushover, a local buckling, local deflection of a wall part. How to check that with your global M star and your global transformation mesh? That's not possible. So if we do a pushover diagram and we see a local shape, for instance the chimney, then we do again eigenfrequency halfway or three quarter of the pushover load. And if we do that, then this will be the first then dominant shape with a new M star, much smaller than the whole building, and another transformation factor. And this represents much more the local failure mechanism, and it's not the MDOF model, the global mode shape 2 anymore. If we then put it in the same Annex B code checking, then we see this chimney is not normative for this calculation. We can do the same with mode 3, and if we do that, we can take the nodal forces around the local deflection part. So we take these nodal forces as the base shear force, and we put that base shear force against the deflection of the inner part with, again, the M star and transformation factor calculated halfway the original pushover diagram. And we end up with a single DOF system that is much more reliable and for the local system. We also checked that by taking out this wall and make a model of only the wall, and it complies with each other. In this way, you can check also in the same speed a very simple housing or a very difficult geometry. It does not matter. And that's the advantage of a higher order calculation. You can also put a time history analysis on it, and then you see the global mode shape 1 and the global mode shape 2 coming back in your time history endings. Only the chimney is not excitated too much in this signal. Well, I hope I have shown you how to analyze some masonry structures. Let's go quickly to the apartment building. It's a new building that will be built in Groningen. In the city, we have to take into account acceleration, peak ground acceleration of 0.22. It has a basement and some 15 levels. It's approximately 15 meter high, and for each level there are 4 apartments. And the shape is some oval ellipse shape, so it's not squared or a box rectangle, so we can expect some rotational sensitivity. And inside there is a core, as you can see on the next slide, and perpendicular to the core there are walls which can take the shear force for the earthquake. In the facade there are columns, round columns and squared columns, and there are 2 extra facade parts, you can say concrete parts, to strengthen the facade. For each floor there is an in-situ concrete slab, and we will analyze this with an RSA and a pushover and a time history again. In this model we used higher order elements, around 470,000. That means we have around 2 million degrees of freedom, and in having such a big huge model with all these slabs, you can imagine that for a linear calculation all these slabs have their own eigenmode, and you have to take a lot of eigenmodes into account to come up to the mass excitated for the whole building. So in this case the RSA took a long time. Of course, you can simplify your model if you would like to reduce the time. That's clear. For the pushover, we did a nonlinear pushover and we did a time history. First, the eigenmodes. The first eigenmode is a rotational mode. The second one in one direction, the third one in the other direction, and then the higher order mode shapes. And as you can see from the right bottom, that you also have all the slabs excitated for themselves. So that means you have a lot of mode shapes. For the RSA, we have, including the importance factor and value, we have to take into account of 0.33G, and we have added all the stresses according to the earlier mentioned CQC method. Sorry, this slide was still in Dutch. By doing that, we need around 600 eigenmodes to come up to around 90% of the total mass of the building, excitated, cumulated. So that's a lot. And at the end, you end up, for example, with bending moments in the basement cellar slab, and the cross-sectional or the shear forces, etc. And you can make a cross-sectional design and see whether your base slab can withstand that bending moment. But you cannot get more out of it. So we think it's not reliable enough for such a building to only do the RSA method. On these three eigenmodes, the first three, we performed a pushover diagram, and we again checked it with the Eurocode, and we saw that this building could take up the forces based on the peak ground acceleration we have taken into account for. But then again, the advantage of a pushover is that you can also see our first slide about the crack width in the pushover. It's around 0.2 millimeter. And the reinforcement stresses in the columns. Maximum is around 220, and there's a lot of compression because of the dead weight, of course. So that's all okay. But the advantage of a pushover is that you can push it over the limit, literally. And for the first eigenmode, the rotational eigenmode, you can see that eventually there are cracks arising. For the second eigenmode, compression strain is becoming too much in the facade, concrete facade, and in the third eigenmode, some inner walls on tension behavior for the reinforcement is the weakest spot. And by defining and those weaker spots, you can say you can make your design even better, although it's already applying or it's already good enough for the code. You can make it even better with simple measures because it's have to be built yet. Well, the third method is of course the time history, and then you see something like this. There's already a lot of pre-cracked zones because of the dead weight. And because of the earthquakes, there are not coming too much cracks next to it. Then we come to the last example of a church tower. The church tower we modeled first very simple with just a compression and a tension diagram, and in Mesh Edit you can give in those materials via dialog boxes. It's either predefined if you do some code materials, or you can define it yourself. And you can define the stress-strain relationships you want. For time history's sake, for time history analysis, we also have, for instance, total strain-based methods, including for the coming Diana futures, the Mekaba model, which is taking into account hysteresis behavior, and especially for the time history calculations, this helps a lot, of course, taking it into account the correct damping on your structure. If you do a pushover analysis, you can see what the maximum base shear force is that can be taken into account, and you can also have some insight about the cracks that occur, and you can see where you have to strengthen it if necessary. Doing the time history analysis, and in this case this direction of the arrow is the most normative direction, so we only prescribe the displacement in that direction. The loads for the time history you can also fill in via a dialog box, and also the time steps necessary for the calculation can be copied pasted from Excel, for instance, into the dialog boxes, so for your own convenience. And the time steps executed walking through the signal you give in the dialog boxes. As an output, for instance, you can have deformations, tensions, stresses, and crack width, either the crack width for each load step or the added crack width, so always the maximum crack width, where that's extremely handy for time history diagrams. Otherwise, the crack closes again, opening again, closes again, and giving only the max will give you a picture about the maximum crack width. You can walk through the signal and you see how cracks are opened and closed again, depending on which way the tower is swayed. We did another model, including the pals underneath them, and then on the right side again you see the deformation, on the left side you see the maximum crack width. So this is the option where we always show the crack growth, and a crack that is opened is not visually not closed again. And walking through the signal, you'll see that the cracks become more and more severe. But the structure is not failing yet. These cracks here on the left side were also seen in the pushover diagram, and especially these were not, because it's a higher order shape where mode shape where this wall was falling out of plane, and that's another mode shape that was not shown in the pushover. So here you see the combined cracking for the time history analysis, where all the mode shapes are taken into account. Well, that's where I want to conclude this webinar for now. The last sheet shows how we are able, with output of Diana for the future, coming future Diana sessions, we can automatically calculate the M-star and the transformation factor, and with those two values you can you are able, or Diana is in the future able, to downscale your M-DOF system to your single DOF system, on which based you can do the code checking. I hope you enjoyed the webinar and you learned something from it. If you have any questions or any options you want to discuss, I will give now the microphone back to Maas, and he will show you the procedure for that part.
Thank you for this interesting presentation. We have some time to address some of your questions, and if you want to share your question, please type it in the chat box, or you can let me know to release your microphone.
Okay, we are receiving a couple of questions. The first question is whether a nonlinear pushover analysis that is also taken into account that the eigenmodes can change during the cracking process. Well, that's what I was trying to explain with the local failure modes. If you have local failure, that can significantly behave different than the global failure of your first eigenmode. Diana can take that into account by doing a new free vibe during your pushover analysis. So you can do your pushover analysis up to certain base shear force, do the eigenfrequency, and continue with the pushover load, do the eigenfrequency again, continue. And in that way, you can take it into account. I hope that answers the question, otherwise you can always email us for further explanation. Another question is, in the pushover diagram, or the pushover analysis, whether that is a displaced or a force-controlled analysis. Well, actually, the mass of the building is placed according to the eigenmode shape you are taking into account. So you can, by the normalized deflections or the normalized displacement, the program is automatically shifting the mass according to that normalized mode shape. But after that, the displacement is force controlled, and it should be for a pushover, of course. So you're putting the mass in a certain shape, that's where you start, but after that, it is a force controlled calculation, of course. For this webinar session, you can afterwards get a link or the sheets in PDF. There were certain questions about that. It's all available if you drop us an email. Another question was, is they used the Richard diaphragm in this model? We have shown you different models, so I have to see on which model you are referring. But I think it is the strengthening of the housing, and that's not a rigid diaphragm. So maybe you can drop me an email about what you are exactly referring to. I think we have in pushover analysis, when you refer to eigenmodes, is it identical with base acceleration in a certain direction? Well, that's not the is not the case. In Diana, it's possible to put your masses in any direction, so it's not it's not necessary to put your mass in the X or the Y direction. You can put the mass of the structure completely in the direction of your eigenmode, so as it really should be. And for the question of the gravity applied for the church, it's indeed the normal gravity is for the dead weight is just in the Z direction. The gravity for the acceleration signal, it is based on the mode shape as I explained. I didn't explain it in the webinar, sorry about that, but in Diana you can make a mode, an eigenmode shape, and Diana scales the mass of the structure according to the normalized displacements of the mode shape. Another question, could you please share how long was the execution running, the analysis running for time for the apartment building? Well, we did some different analysis. We did an RSA for that big model, pushover diagrams and time history analysis. For the around 250 eigenmode shapes in the RSA and analysis, I know that it took about a night. That's also the case for that big model for the pushover analysis. It's about 1.5 days, so a night and a half day. And for the time history, I'm not sure anymore. It depends a lot on how many steps, of course, you take into the signal. But it takes a few days, you can say. It's a very big model. Okay, then there are some questions about the Meikawa model. The Meikawa model, I showed you here that you can use that, and it was actually not used in the models we showed you, because these are all cases, test cases, and not real project cases. And the real project cases, we cannot show them all to you. But for the question for the Meikawa model is what kind of parameters are you using? The answer is not so simple for that, because there are more Meikawa models available in Diana, and they are you can drop us an email and we can get back to you on that. Well, it looks like I've answered all the questions. If you still have some questions, please be free to drop us an email and we get back to you. If you want any further information about how to model things or how to do those projects, please drop us an email as well.